How's it going, everybody? John here, and today is Wicked Wednesday, which means I deliver a video or an essay or a game or something to all of my patrons. And today we're going to talk a little bit about Canon. And no, I don't mean the weapons that are loaded onto ships. I mean the inner continuity and consistency of a setting. Like every other literary tool, Canon can be something that's really important and can be really useful. And then you can fetishize it. I mean, how many hairs do hobbits have on their feet? For me as a game master, Canon is a tool that I use to tell stories. It helps me communicate a consistency to my players and gives us a common language that we can communicate in. So what I'm going to do today is I'm going to look at a few games that have deep canon and show you how to weaponize it. That's right, it's a play dirty video. Let's start with this one. So I wrote this book, it's got my name on the spine and everything, and when I wrote it, I had a goal of not burying the player base with lore. I wanted them to know about as much as they needed to know to play the game and run the game, and that was it. And I also communicated very clearly that your Rokugan may vary, and that's a phrase I learned from Greg Stafford. And we'll be talking a little bit about that in a bit. I wanted players and game masters to know that they could do what they wanted with the game. I've had people come up to me at cons and say in this hesitant, almost frightened voice, John, I ran an L5R game where the Scorpion Clan won the Scorpion Clan coup. Is that okay? And I'm like, yes, of course it's okay. You get to do whatever you want with that world. You get to take that book and change it the way you want. Now, if you change it so much that it no longer looks like Rokugan, the world of Legend of the Five Rings, then what's the point of using Rokugan? It's kind of like how I feel about the Starship Troopers movie. That movie is not Heinlein's book, and say what you want about Heinlein's politics. You can agree with them, you can disagree with them. I agree with some of them, and I disagree with others. If you're going to transform the book into something completely different, then why are you using the book? And to give you an example of what I'm talking about, I've recently been running Legend of the Five Rings over on Start Playing Games, and throughout the game, I've been challenging the players' notions of honor, because that's what the game is really about. The game is about telling the players, you believe this, you believe this, and you believe this, and now disagree. It's a game about honor. What is honor? And what does it mean to have honor or be honorable? It's an interesting question that still intrigues me. But I've recently thrown a wrench into my players' little toolbox that doesn't quite fit anything. You see, they've been investigating an organized crime gang that's pervasive all over Rokugan. And what I wanted to do is I wanted to take the Yakuza and really take them at their face value, believe what they say about themselves. They were the people who protected people that the samurai didn't care about. Okay, let's put that in Rokugan and find out what happens. So first I confronted them with a Yakuza boss who is actually a samurai, or was a samurai. He is using all of his skills and talents to help people in a way that he couldn't when he was a samurai, but now he can because he's a crime boss. And he's using all of the vices, prostitution and drugs and all the rest of it, to provide money to help people. He's taking advantage of the vicious to help the innocent. It's kind of a Robin Hood in a more philosophical way. And when the players encountered him, of course, they had their presuppositions. They went in with all kinds of attitude in their head, which the book firmly plants there. And then I introduced them to the secret writings of Shinsei. Actually, in the game, I called them the lost writings of Shinsei, but now that I realize that they should have been called the secret writings of Shinsei, well, then those, you know, let's think about that for a second. Because secret means something different than lost. Secret means it's between you and me and nobody else. And lost means it's gone. That there was something here, but it's been removed. Yeah, I think lost is actually better. And what the secret writings of Shinsei say is that Rokugan is not supposed to be a caste system. in a tiered cast system in the way that it is, it's supposed to look more like a wheel. And this is something that I adapted from 7th Sea Katai. And the wheel has spokes, and every spoke maintains the wheel and allows it to move. Each cast is a spoke on that wheel, including samurai, peasants, merchants, and the emperor. Of course, my players immediately said, "Forgery!" And they made all kinds of rolls to say, "This is a forgery." And I was like, "No, actually, this looks legit." And then they went back into the writings of Shinsei and said, "Okay, let's see how this works." And because they've seen this other book, they realize that part of the original writings of Shinsei have been changed. There is a space where this book could fit into the canonical canon. And now the players are wondering, what do we do with this? They spent half of an entire session just talking about it. And the next time we play, we'll find out what they do with it. They may destroy it. They may decide to burn it and get rid of it. We'll see what happens. You gotta let the players do what they're gonna do. Okay, I mentioned your Rokugan may vary and that I took that from Greg Stafford because in RuneQuest, your Glorantha may vary. That's actually where the term comes from, is this game. There's a couple hurdles you need to overcome to become a RuneQuest player, and one of them is the lore. It's dense. Ugh. See this? This is the Guide to Glorantha. This is, it's a lot of pages. And this is, honestly, right here, just skimming the surface. Now, the second problem with becoming a RuneQuest player is, honestly, the Glorantha Grognards. I went on a Facebook page once, and being a fan of Greg's Red Goddess, I said, "Hey, I would like to know more about the Lunar Empire, which is a big important element of Glorantha. And where could somebody point me at a place to start?" And one player said, "Well, you can't understand anything about the Lunar Empire unless you understand this 2,000 years of history, and that gives it all context, and you can't understand a thing until you understand that." And to me, that sounds like you can't understand the American Civil War unless you've studied Greek history. I mean, yes, will studying Greek history give you a history, in fact, of democracy and the idea of and Plato's idea of a republic, which was used as a basis to set up the United States, but the United States had built-in problems with it, including slavery, which led to the Civil War? Yeah, but do I really need to know Greek history, the history of Greece, to understand the Civil War? No. So with these two big problems, how do you get new players into RuneQuest? I'll tell you. You go south. You see, there are two big continents in Glorantha, and one is the northern continent, which Greg, like, as an anthropologist, like, dug through and highly detailed its history, its politics, its religions, you know, all that kind of stuff. And then there's the southern continent. And while there have been things written about the southern continent, there's not a lot there. So why don't we start a game of new players in the southern continent of Glorantha? And because Greg was a big fan of Joseph Campbell, let's use his ideas of the masks of God and take all of the big Gloranthan northern continent gods and move them down south and reinterpret them. So instead of the storm tribes of Orlanth, which is up in the northern continent, down south we have the Thunder Thrones. And these are like the Greek city-states, where they're all united by a common culture, but they all stand alone and independent, and if you want to get them all to do something, well, you gotta go talk to them. So they're a lot less like the Thunder Tribes up north, where they are independent of each other, but they're all bound by a common culture. And you have the Empire of the Sun, which is one of the big faiths up in northern Glorantha. But here, it's instead of a kind of like a dying faith, it is a prospering faith. And it's also a corrupt one. The character of any empire is defined by its emperor, and this one is, well, he's ambitious. He's tired of these other gods. He wants Glorantha to fall under monotheism, the worship of the sun, and all the other faiths are heresy. And speaking of heresy, instead of the Lunar Empire, you have Lunar Mystics. The religion of the moon is a revelatory one, in that you have illumination. You get revealed secret truths by the moon. Much like the beginnings of Christianity, there's no real authority here. Everybody gets revelations, and they're personal. So to call back to Christianity again, it's more Gnostic. It's individualistic. What is your vision that the goddess gave you? What is your vision that the goddess gave you? And the cult, or the religion of the moon, pops up in different places. It pops up over in the Thunder Thrones. It pops up in the Solar Empire. And it pops up everywhere. And so the cult of the moon has to go to all these other places, like the Thunder Thrones and the Earth tribes and things like that, and has to go, hey, help us. These other places, they want to make sure that the Empire of the Sun doesn't, you know, get too big for its britches. So here we go. Do you have Orlanth? Yes. Do you have the Red Goddess? Yes. Do you have the Earth Goddess? Yes, but she takes a different form here. That's all of the big gods of Glorantha take different forms in the southern continent. So if someone from the northern continent came down here, they'd recognize them. And I know what some of you Glorantha grognards are thinking. And that's a way that you can meddle with Gloranthan lore and not meddle with it, because you're doing something that's elsewhere. So all the grognards, with all of their, you have to understand this, can stay up in the northern continent where they're happy and they know everything and they gatekeep you from playing the game. And we can play down in the southern continent. And the last one I want to talk about today is... Vampyr is a really important game to me as a game designer, as a player, and as a GM. That doesn't mean I don't have problems with it. I have a lot of problems with it, but it's still really super important. And so I run it with a couple of minor tweaks to the setting and the lore to make things more interesting for me and to throw my players off. See, Vampyr players love lore because that's another way they can protect themselves from the GM. I'm going to make a whole video about Vampyr one day, but in a nutshell, Vampyr players have been taught by the game that they have to protect themselves from the GM, because the GM is going to come and mess with them. I still remember being here in Phoenix, before I lived here. I came out here for the International Chimera Conventicle, or whatever the hell it was called. And the group of us were sitting around a table, and a GM dropped a wallet on the table and said, "This wallet suddenly appears on your table. You don't know how it got there, it just suddenly appears." And one of the players turned to him and said, "No, Mr. Storyteller, I am not interested in your plot." And I think that perfectly sums up a particular kind of Vampyr player that seems to be a wide percentage of the base. They create characters that are protected in every way. They have super defensible havens. They make that nobody knows who I am, you know, in all these different ways. And they sit like a Fallout character in a bunker, protecting themselves from the rest of the world so the world can't hurt me. It's about as annoying as Teddy Bear Malkavians. But that's a tangent. Let's get back to how we're going to tweak the lore to make Vampyr a little bit more, well, interesting to me, at least. When the first book came out, the Sabbat were a complete mystery. Nobody knew what the Sabbat was. And when material started coming out about the Sabbat, it had this Catholic Church vibe to it. It was the cult of Cain, worshiping Cain, because in the world of Vampyr, Cain, as in Cain and Abel, Cain, he's the first vampire because he's the first murderer, and he commits the first murder. Well, yeah. And so the mark of Cain is that he's a vampire. He passes that on to others so that he doesn't feel alone, kind of like Hannibal Lecter trying to recruit Clarice Starling and Will Graham, because Hannibal Lecter is lonely and he wants friends that he can dine with. And as more material came out on the Sabbat, I liked it less and less. I had my own idea about what the Sabbat was, and this other thing seemed more like, well, as the phrase goes, the Camarilla painted black. So in my game that I'm running over at Start Playing Games,
Link in the doobly-doo.
Yeah, doobly-doo-yah. Thanks, Mr. Monster.
Yeah, you're welcome, yeah.
At that vampire game, I'm treating the Sabbat a little different. And it's not much different. I just kind of got rid of that Catholic thing. See, I went to Catholic school as a kid. Yeah, I hated it. And all the Sabbat LARPs I went to, it's like chanting Praise Cain seemed to be the goal of the game. So instead, the Sabbat in my game are what they call true vampires. See, all those Camarilla vampires with their humanity, they're trying to hold on to something that they aren't anymore. They're not real vampires. They're vampires in transition. They haven't made the last step yet. And the Sabbat, they've made that last step. Now, if this sounds like the basis or the core of the original Sabbat, it is. It's just with all the Catholic trappings stripped away. But more importantly, the Camarilla vampires who are still clinging to their humanity, that's why all of those human symbols affect them so much. The sun burning you alive is because you are trying to hold on to your humanity. The crosses, all of that kind of stuff, all that human symbolism is what's holding you back. You have to let go of it and become a real vampire and get rid of your humanity. And once you do that, you can walk around in the sun. You're no longer afraid of fire. You're no longer afraid of crosses. And you don't feel compelled to drink blood. You drink blood when you need it. So when my vampire players, who are playing Liberty by Night, which is Liberty is a city, it's a fake city, just north of Phoenix. And Liberty is an anarch city, Phoenix is a Camarilla city, and Tucson is a Sabbat city. And I built that so the players could encounter all these different kinds of vampires. And when they had to go out to Tucson for a certain reason, and they ran into the Sabbat, not only did they find out that everything they were told about the Sabbat, about all the Catholic symbolism and that they just wanted to kill you and they're just monsters, was all wrong. Everything that's in this book about the Sabbat is Camarilla propaganda. And they told them, the Sabbat vampires are like, hey, look, you're just stuck in this place and you have to decide what to do. You're in transition. And until you complete the transition, you're going to be stuck there, afraid of fire, burning in the sun. All of that stuff, that's baggage from you being human. Once you ditch being human, you don't have to worry about it anymore. And I had to pitch it hard. I had to pitch it really hard. Especially the part about the Antediluvians. If you're not a fan of vampire, then one of the big subplots running through vampire is that the Antediluvian vampires, the vampires who were around before the flood, and the flood put them all to sleep. So they're all asleep under the ground, but they're so powerful that they can send out telepathic messages and they can control vampires of their lineage through the blood. So if you are a Nosferatu vampire, the Nosferatu Antediluvian is secretly controlling you. And the only way to break that is a secret that the Sabbat know. And so when my players encountered all this, they were kind of taken aback. They're like, okay, this sort of fits what we know about the Sabbat, but it's actually kind of sexier. And that was my goal. I wanted them to be tempted by the Sabbat. Not to view them as an enemy, per se, but the true nature of the Bram Stoker vampire, the seducer. Come with me and leave all of this mortal stuff behind. And once they understood what that was, and all the stuff in this book was propaganda, that changed things up a bit. As a matter of fact, one of my players joined them. Yes! You know what? I just saw something on my shelf that gave me an idea. No, really, honestly, I was looking down, I was thinking about how to close this video out, and I saw something on my bookshelf. Hold on one second. This book. Hey! It's the Gith Yankee. I love the Gith Yankee. I think they're fantastic. And there's the story in there of what the Gith Yankee are. But what if it's all wrong? I mean, the Gith Yankee are such an integral part of D&D lore. It seems hard to change them in such a way that would be meaningful, but without losing what they are. I mean, the caricature of Get the Yankee is so overwhelmingly powerful that it's difficult to, I mean, it's so unelastic. It's difficult to think of a way to change them in a way that would make them different and more than just bwahaha, curl my mustache villains. I'll think about it. I don't have anything yet, but I'll think about it. And that is your Wicked Wednesday video for this week. Hey, I hope you liked it. If you did, go ahead and click like. And if you super liked it, go ahead and subscribe. And if you super duper liked it, you know what to do. Go ahead and go to my Patreon link in the doobly-doo. For just $5, $5 a month, you get access to all of the videos that I've made, all of the essays I've written, all of the games I've released over on Patreon. Some of them are only on Patreon. And you also get a discount for all my Start Playing Games games. So think about canon. Think about ways that you can twist it up and make your characters stumble into unexpected territory where they have to question everything that they know is true. I mean, that's one of the great things about a role-playing game. When the GM throws you a curveball, like, the Sabbat might not be the bad guys, or Shinsei's writings may be corrupt, or, hey, there's a whole other world of gods and things down in Southern Glorantha. Or even, hey, the Get Yankee are the secret heroes of the astral plane. The players themselves will have a moment, a Philip K. Dick moment, where they wonder, what else do I know for certain that isn't true? And then you can do the GM dance. So until next time, think about it, and I will see you next time, next Wednesday. Till then, you know what to do. Take care of yourselves, take care of other people, and most importantly, don't let anyone tie you to your game's canon.